Good morning, man of church. I'm so happy and excited that you are joining us this morning for church at home. I know these last few weeks and even these last few days have been pretty difficult with all the changing requirements in the CDC and the government, kind of how they're telling us to meet. The church staff has worked hard to ensure that we're able to still bring you an inspiring worship service, just kind of in a different platform. So I want to say thank you to all the staff for all the hard work you've put in to make all of this possible, for all of our serve team members and all of our serve team leaders and small group leaders that are reaching out to all of their teams and all those people in the small groups. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Andrew Vasquez, and don't adjust your camera. There's nothing wrong with it. This is my happy and excited face. I'm just kidding. Hey, this is my happy and excited face, and I'm truly happy that you've decided to join us this morning for church at home. I've missed you all so much. I missed the high fives. I missed the fist bumping. I missed the smiling faces. But most importantly, I miss just talking with all of you. If you're like me, you're probably going through withdrawals, but the good thing is in the man of church, we take care and look out for one another. Also, a big shout out to all of our small group leaders, our serve team leaders who've been reaching out to check on everyone. Bless you guys. Appreciate you so much. If you're a first-time guest and you want to get plugged in, if what I just said is attracted to you and you want to get plugged in, we can do that. All you have to do is let us know. If you're on Facebook, just type in first-time guest, and one of our staff members will be in contact with you here in the coming days and get you connected to a life-giving small group. Even if you need prayers, just go to our website, fill out our prayer form. We'd love to be praying for you. Next, it's time for Check-In for Change. If you're on Facebook right now, all you have to do is scroll up to the top, click that little button that says Check-In. It's a little drop on the right-hand side. Click that, check into Mana Church, West Florida, 800 East John Sims Parkway. I know that's not where we're at right now. You're at your home, and we still want to check in and bless our partners. So here's how this works. For every person that checks in right now and throughout the month, we're going to give $1 to this partner organization. At the end of the month, we're going to tally up everyone who's checked in. And because we're doing online and the majority of you are watching via Facebook, we should have one of the biggest months ever that we can bless this partner organization. And this month, we partnered up with RUN Ministries. Now, RUN stands for Reaching Unreached Nations. And what they do is they spread the gospel in the Middle East. And if you haven't, I know most of you have been reading the news, but if you haven't seen it, that's one of the places that's been hit hardest by this pandemic. So we'd love to bless them as they continue their ministry in that area. Next up is Next Step. We are offering Next Step virtually. That's right, virtually. Through Right Now Media. We'd love to have you join us. If you don't know what Next Step is, it's our four-week small group that gives us a chance to tell you a little bit about who we are as a church, why we're here, where we're going, but most importantly, what's your part in that. All you have to do is, if you're on Facebook, is type in sign me up. We'll get someone in contact with you. You get an email. If you're not watching us through Facebook, you can jump onto our webpage and we'd love to get you signed up for that. Last thing I have for you, we are 2 weeks away from Easter. Super excited. Take a look at this video. Excited. Hope you can join us for Easter. You should be getting one of these in your mailbox here in the coming days. If you look on the back, you'll see it does have times on there. Of course, we won't be meeting. We'll be meeting here online where you're at, 10 a.m. Excited to have you. Love you guys. Miss you. Here's Pastor Chris.
Well, here we go, man of church. It is so good to see all of you, or maybe I should say it is so good to know that I'm being seen by all of you. Welcome here to Mana Church online version. This is now our third week doing this. Of course, now you certainly know why. The whole world knows why. And from the moment that this took place, where it really got close to home, the coronavirus started to become the headline each and every day. Two words popped into my heart straight from Scripture. It's the two words that are behind me back there, fear not. And if you don't know, this is actually the number one directive in all of Scripture. 366 times this phrase comes up from God's heart towards us, truly letting us know to not be afraid, to fear not. So 366, that's one for every day. It happens to be a leap year. So this is the perfect timing for us to dive into this truth. And here's the plus side of that. If you're thinking, man, I'm afraid all the time, that must be terrible. Well, think about this. The heroes of our faith, that means that they needed to be reminded by God not to have fear. That Abraham and Sarah and Moses and Isaac and the disciples and David and the Apostle Paul, they're the ones primarily that God was speaking to about fearing not. So we find ourselves in pretty good company. What I hope to do with this sermon is just lay a foundation. We're going to have part one this week and come back next week to where we realize that hope always wins. This week, I want to lay a foundation and get us to understand what fear is, why we fear, what it looks like when we fear, and ultimately how to overcome that fear. So we're going to lay down this foundation today. And again, I need you to understand before we dive in too deep that I consider fear to be something where there's a healthy version of fear and, of course, an unhealthy version. We're going to look at how to get away from the unhealthy version. Let me just tell you real quick what the healthy version is. A healthy version is how God designed your body, a part of your nervous system, to sense danger and get out of the way. Kind of that fight or flight thing that you learned about in elementary school. That's good. Someone throws a chair at your head and you duck. That's good, healthy fear. We're all wired for that. Also, there's fear, healthy, wise, healthy fear. If you're not trained to be a beekeeper, don't run towards a swarm of bees. If you're not trained to put out fires, don't run towards a fire. If you're not trained for combat, something explodes, you probably need to move away at first. That's wise fear. I'd actually say what our nation is doing right now in the midst of this virus is wise, healthy fear, okay? We're called to be a fearless church. I'm going to talk about how to fear less here in a minute. We're not called to be a careless church. So I think wisdom and fear, these are healthy things. And of course, one of the predominant fears that comes up in Scripture is a healthy fear of God. And if you just don't like those two words going together, fear God, all you have to do, I just learned this at a young age, substitute fear with trust, because that's what it really means. And as we're going to discover as we go through this, it's those of us who are in awe of something else, we let it capture our attention, that's when we get in trouble. Those are unhealthy fears. But when we put all of our awe and our reverence and our fear and our trust towards God, all the other fears go away. So healthy fear, fight or flight stuff, wisdom, of course, taking precautions when there's true danger around, like we're dealing again with this virus, and of course, a healthy fear of God. That's what we're not going to talk about today. What we are going to talk about today is unhealthy fear. When we're stuck in that fight or flight scenario, and it lingers, and it's prolonged, and it keeps us down, and it makes us not even be able to think, and we're anxious, and we're worried, and we're on edge. That's the type of fear that God does not want us to go anywhere near. I actually think fear is an emotion that we're going to talk about, similar to anger. You know, the Bible says in James to be angry but not sin. I think fear is very similar. Fear is going to hit you. You're going to be tempted to get stuck in it. What do we do next? Doubts are going to hit you. How do you apply faith to doubts? How do you apply trust to fear? So that's where we're going today. As I said, when this whole pandemic got real and truly came into our neighborhood, the first two words that came into my mind were fear not, and the first verse were a passage that says those exact words. I'm going to read this to us. We're going to look at this together, and I just want you to listen, and I want you to be honest about how you feel. Because if you've read your Bible a while, you know this is true based on what you know in your head. Where I want to get is where you actually believe this in your heart and trust it in your heart. So just listen to this. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10 says this, "Fear not, for I am with you." This is God to the children of Israel through the prophet Isaiah. "Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Now again, if you've read your Bible a few times, you've seen that verse or many similar to it. And in your head, you're probably saying amen. But in times like these, I wonder if your heart truly believes it. My goal really is to lay out a teaching today so that by the time we get to the end of this, you know how to go from your head to the heart with truly applying. We're going to learn how to fear not over the next few minutes together. Does that sound good? Can we do that? All right. Here, and I really hope that this teaching blesses you, affirms you, and honestly, I hope this is really what I've been studying over the last 2 weeks, dealing with my own fears, dealing with my own anxieties. I hope that this teaching works obviously for you, Manna Church, and I also hope it's something you can send, because many of the prayer requests that have come in haven't been just for you. It's been you asking for prayer for your aunt who's really fearful right now, or for your mom or dad that don't live here. And so I hope this is a teaching that you can share with them as well. So let's start with the basics. What is fear? I'm actually just going to give you the Webster's definition, and then we're going to build upon that. I'm going to bring it down a little bit. But fear, simply, according to the dictionary, is this: an unpleasant emotion caused by the belief that someone or something dangerous is likely to cause pain or a threat. So again, it's an unpleasant emotion. That's the key here. Fear, of course, is an emotion. At first, chairs being thrown towards your head, it's a good emotion that tells you to get out of the way. We're not talking about that kind. We're talking about the kind that never goes away. So I'm going to bring that definition down and just define a fear like this: when what is undesirable feels unavoidable. So it's really like what we're going to deal with today is when I don't like this collides with I can't stop this. And it's that collision that then remains a constant in our soul, in our heart, and it truly takes over. That's what I believe the enemy wants to do to us, keep us stuck right there. And I know that's what God wants to cast out of our lives. If you're like me, you've actually probably woken up somewhere in the last 10 days with a little bit of a scratchy throat, right? And a little bit of cough. And instantly, what does your mind do? I must have caught the virus. You go about 3 to 4 stages ahead. You're already seeing yourself taking the test, checked into the ICU, wondering if there's going to be ventilators. Somebody go to the store and get more toilet paper or whatever. You just start going down the road. And what is that? That's fear running amok in your heart, running rampant, taking you to places that you didn't think of in that moment until it actually started to affect you. But many of you are dealing with real life stuff right now. Some of you had to, you've been let off work, or your small business is struggling right now. You're concerned for your kids and maybe the type of school they go to, or how's this gonna work online, and when am I gonna get my stimulus check, or whatever it may be. There's real life problems going on. It's leading to a moment of fear. The question is, where do we take it from there? How do we get out of this collision of undesirable and unavoidable? What do we do with that emotion? How do we take it to God? Let me give you 3 reasons why we fear. And honestly, I got this from a book I just dove into recently. My wife got me this book a while ago and just started reading again. Goliath Must Fall by one of my favorite communicators, Louis Giglio. Over the last 2 decades, he's been my go-to communicator. He's got a chapter in here on fear, giants in our life, fear and rejection and bitterness. I mean, great book, but specifically, he tells us there's 3 reasons why we fear. And again, I'm not a psychologist, but I think these 3 really sum up 3 of the main reasons that you and I struggle with fear. Number 1, it comes down to our conditioning, not our physical fitness, because then I'd be afraid all the time, but truly the environment we grew up in, for many of us, even the cultures. There's certain cultures with different superstitions, and some cultures fear things over others for various reasons, or really the environments you've been with. How many of you had maybe a parent? You don't have to shout out which one, and if you're in their living room with them now, you don't have to point at them, but maybe you had a mom who just worried all the time about your physical health or your safety. Maybe you had a parent who just saw your parents constantly fearful of running out of money or not having enough money. These are the conditioning environments that usually shape us to live and operate with certain fears. Maybe you grew up in a home where self-image, getting exposed for who we really weren't, was a huge fear, and you could sense it. You couldn't quite articulate it then, but now you realize that's a part of your life. And that leads to the second reason that many of us fear, not just our conditioning, it's what we've been trying to conceal, the concealing reality. We are almost always afraid of getting exposed, getting caught. It's why we put on a front. Now, I realize you go through life, sometimes you can't always let everybody know how you feel, but there's got to be some people. That's why church is so important. There's got to be people where you drop your guard, you take off your mask, you let them in, you let them know that you're really not all that, because they already know you're not all that. And we stop concealing, but there's a lot of us that are afraid of getting caught. There's a lot of us that are afraid of being exposed for who we really are. And I think what's one of the driving factors of fear in many of our lives. With this crisis, with this shakeup, I mean, there's things getting exposed right now. Man, if you're having a tough time at home already, when you could go to work every day or go to the gym every day, and now you're all stuck there, my goodness. This is a tough time. We all just got to get real and deal with what's going on. Get over those fears by stop concealing. So conditioning, concealing, and here's where we're going to park most of our time today, controlling. I mean, at the end of the day, we really, really enjoy having control. And I'll be honest, half the reason I'm watching the news so closely is I want to find out what's coming next so I can get a plan in order, so I can get back to normal. But here's maybe what God is teaching us. You can never have a full handle on what's going to happen next. And these times like this is just exposing the reality that none of us are in control. Everybody wants to rule the world. Did I just quote Tears for Fears? I think I just did. But anyways, what I'm getting at is you and I desire to be controlling, and that is one of the main reasons that we fear. Conditioning, concealing, controlling. Worrying and controlling go hand in hand. Martin Luther, the great reformer, said he defined worrying as trying to rule the world. So we're going to obviously come back to this one again. Let me tell you three things that fear does, and I doubt they're going to surprise you. So what am I doing? I'm kind of digging us into a hole right now, and then we're going to let God dig us out. Listen to me with these three things. I think this covers pretty much every way fear affects our life. Number one is that fear debilitates. Fear debilitates. What do I mean by that? It weakens us. It chips away at us. One of the easiest ways to think about this is think about what we're called to do as Christians. Ephesians chapter 6. We're called to stand firm in the armor of God. But what does fear do? Fear starts to put cracks in our armor. Think about it. The helmet of salvation. A crack in your helmet of salvation, and you begin to doubt. You begin to doubt who God has truly called you to be. Think about your chest plate of righteousness. We learned about this in the last series, right? Righteousness. We're declared righteous by God because of what Jesus has done for us. Well, when you have a crack in your chest plate of righteousness, you no longer truly believe that Jesus has done enough and that Jesus is enough. Guess what? Fear and religion, they're like cousins. They hang out real close. And so you begin to get religious because of fear. You begin to be ashamed when you sin, so you don't let it. Shame, fear, and control go hand in hand in hand over and over again. You get a crack in your chest plate of righteousness. Your belt of truth, you can't even find it. You don't fully trust God. You're not fully in awe of God, so now you're in awe of other things, and you're allowing false idols into your life. Your belt's gone. You're exposed. Your shoes of peace, You can't even find your shoes. There's no peace. You can't, my kids, I've driven all the way to school with children without shoes. That's a little sidetrack comment there right now, just to relate to some of the parents, but you can't even find your shoes. There's no peace. If there's no peace, you know fear is somewhere near. Honestly, the opposite of fear is peace. The way to get there is through faith, and that's what God wants to teach us. We've got to be shored up in His armor. A shield of faith, yeah, you got one, but it's tiny. It's almost like a coaster. So you're frantically trying to defend yourself against the schemes of the enemy. Fear's coming in. Sword of the Spirit, you know it in your head, but it's not quite in your heart. So it feels like you don't even have the strength to pick it up. That's what fear does. It debilitates us and chips away at us moment by moment. Once it starts to debilitate us, then it leads to the second thing that fear does, and it stagnates us. What I mean by that is, It paralyzes us. We literally feel like we're in quicksand and we're stuck and we can't move and I don't know what I'm gonna do. And you begin to perpetuate, as I alluded to earlier, you perpetuate this negative narrative that runs out ahead, 3, 4, 5 steps ahead. None of them are even realistic, but that's where you actually feel frozen and I'm gonna end up in some irrational place that I had no idea, I wasn't even thinking about it before, and it's brought an anxiety completely new, and I'm absolutely stuck. Believe it or not, this leads to health issues. Again, God designed you for that fight or flight thing to get you out of a certain situations quickly and then move on. Some of us are stuck there. Some of us wake up with that type of stress, that type of anxiety, that type of tension, and it's prolonged. It's truly, even from the inside out, rotting us. So not only does fear debilitate, not only does fear stagnate, it also, and this I think is the enemy's number one scheme for fear, it isolates. It causes you and I, one, to falsely feel like we're the only ones going through this and we're all alone. Two, once you feel that shame, you truly begin to draw away. Now, I don't know when you caved in, parents, but a couple days into this, we went ahead and got Disney Plus. I mean, it just seemed like the thing to do. And with Disney Plus, of course, you get a National Geographic channel. With National Geographic, I mean, I'm actually binge watching that more than Disney Plus. And you'll see these shows with the animals and the lions, they're on the prowl. And of course, you know how this works. When they're coming against a herd, they never attack them when they're all together. What are they waiting for? They're waiting for one to get far enough on his own, just kind of munching on the grass, looks up, where'd all my buddies go? That's when it's too late. And if you think about it, that really is the enemy's scheme, is to get us on our own. Step number one for the enemy is, we're the sheep of our great shepherd, Jesus. Step number one is to get us far enough away from eyesight to Jesus or earshot to Jesus. We don't even hear his voice anymore. And that's step one, that we can no longer see our shepherd. Step two, because here's the thing, you can be there, but look up and still see a few of the peripheral sheep or the sheep that are on the edge of the flock. That's not a bad thing, because then at the very least, you can follow them as they follow Christ. It's not the best place to be, but it's not the worst place to be. What's the enemy ultimately want you to do? Get you away from the flock. Get you away from all of the sheep. That's absolutely where he's got you best. Now you're alone. Now you can't hear a thing, you can't see a thing, and you have no friends. You have no friends to give out a bleat for you to help, to let the shepherd know and you're absolutely stuck. And that's what happens with fear. You're never your best self when you're by yourself. You're never your best self. And that's what the isolation of fear does. So again, it debilitates, breaks us down, it stagnates us, we absolutely get stuck, and of course, it isolates us. All right, we're in a hole. I don't know if you're feeling good right now. You might feel stuck, or maybe you're nodding your head a whole bunch. That's how I'm feeling. Let's look at three ways how to fear not. Ultimately, how to overcome being weakened and paralyzed and isolated by faith. I'm gonna give you one thing to stop. It's not gonna be easy, but I'm gonna encourage you to do it. I'm gonna give you one thing to start, and then one person, of course, to seek. I'm grateful for this teaching. I recently listened to something very similar from Tim Keller a podcast of his teaching through the Psalms. I highly encourage anything he's taught to you as well. But here's the number one thing. The first thing we need to stop when it comes to how to fear not is simply this. Stop ruling the world. Stop ruling the world. You need to make this a daily practice. Take yourself off the throne and put complete trust in God. He is in control. And there's three truths that you've likely already wrestled with, or maybe you haven't. At the end of the day, God will prove these three truths to every human being on planet Earth. Whether they learn them all three at once when every knee is bowed and every tongue confessed that Jesus is Lord, whether it takes that long, or somewhere in your journey of following Jesus, you will learn these three truths, likely in this order, not necessarily, but likely your heart will need to bow down to these three simple truths. And they're absolutely incredibly simple. There's just something about us wanting to rule our own worlds and even be in more control. But we got to stop ruling the world. Number one has to do with our rebellion, and that's the simple truth that God is right. God is right. And I would say for me, this was somewhere between the ages, about a 4-year span between ages 18 and 22, that I had to fully concede that God, you're right. I can't approach, like, your word and your ways are smarter than mine. They're more righteous than mine. Like, they work. It was in that time span I stopped cheating. Like, literally, I am ashamed to say it, but I cheated pretty much through high school. I was concealing. I had a fear of being exposed, and I wanted control. And God, you're right. My relationships finally aligned my relationships with God. The way I treated my parents, the way I treated others. God, you're right. God, you're right. Here's a huge lesson in that. Psalm 3, verse 3 is a great protection psalm, and it literally says that God puts a shield around us. But here's how it works. This it's a battlefield shield, and it's designed as you follow your commander into battle. And you are completely covered as long as you're following him. Here's why disobedience puts us in incredibly vulnerable places. If you were to take that shield and turn and run away from the battle, run away from what's fearful, if you were to turn and run away, you'd be completely exposed because the shield doesn't fully cover your back. It only works when you're obeying. It only works when you're following your leader through even what gives you the most fear. And believe it or not, obedience through those times is the way to be protected most. God is right. Here's the second truth. God is good. If he teaches us that he's right, and you know this, God is so patient, God is so faithful, his love is so steadfast, he will give you a long time to figure out these lessons. But the quicker you learn them, the quicker you can learn how to fear not. So God is right. He teaches us that he's right, mostly dealing with our own rebellion and showing us that choosing him will be the way forward through peace. Then he wants to teach us that he's good. God is good. And the way that he primarily teaches us that is through trials. And I don't want to say he forces us, but he gives us opportunity to finally let go of things that we've been holding on to, that we just imagined would be better, or to stop reaching for things not in his timing, or to start, at the end of the day, again, stop ruling the world, start trusting him more, even with daily provision. In the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, he gives a number of verses simply about that sentiment, that, hey, look at the birds, look at the flowers, I take care of them. Like, they don't fly around worrying for stuff. They don't grow. And if I take care of the birds and I take care of the flowers, don't you think I'm going to take good care of you? Like, what are you going to gain by worrying about things? And it's just this beautiful passage to say, man, would we just trust that he's good? Like, that waiting on his timing, that trusting that even through this trial, he's going to be good. We've got to get that. We got to stop ruling the world. Trust that he's right. Trust that he's good. No more FOMO, no more fear of missing out. Really, God's got this. He's going to take care of us. And the third one, I don't know if you've learned this lesson, but He will take all of us through this at some point. And it's the most basic of all. It's that God is God. And this isn't really about trials as much as it's about tragedy. And there's a number of you that have had a death in the family, or maybe just some injustice that you've seen firsthand. And you begin to realize, okay, this shakes up everything. God, I just got to trust that you're God. I don't get this. I could spend every day from here on out asking you why. But as opposed to asking why, I'm just going to stand on who you are. You're right, you're good, and at the end of the day, you're God. First thing we need to do is stop ruling the world. You know you're not anyways, but give it up, get off the throne. God is right, God is good, God is God. Second thing, stop that. Now start taking the test. Start, this isn't fun either, but we gotta do it. Start taking the test. What if adversity is the university, but you just keep skipping class? It's just gonna keep coming around and around and around. I mean, I'm not making light of this scenario. This is a very revealing time for all of us. If you struggled with fear before three, four weeks ago, oh my goodness. But God wants, there's something in this that He's trying to do in you. It is not selfish for you to go into your quiet time with God and say, God, what are you trying to get at in me? That's a good place to start. Praise Him and then quickly shift to, Lord, what is it you want me to learn through this? Because I don't want to keep stiff-arming this test. I want to go right into it. God's always teaching us. He's so big that He can have a billion little exams going on right now in the midst of one global pandemic. Don't miss that opportunity to learn. He's not just the teacher giving the test. He'll be your tutor as well to help you. You can lean into both sides of who He wants to be. In James, it's said this way, right? Consider it pure joy. That means trust God. Consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds because you know that the testing of your faith, it does something. It produces something. It's a test designed to produce perseverance and character. And perseverance, when it finishes its work, we're perfect and mature and complete. That's the path God has us on. I love the passage out of Romans. Very similar, but let me read it to you. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, since we've been justified by faith, don't ever doubt that, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, peace really is the opposite of fear. The antidote of fear is faith. Trusting in God, having faith in God gets us to a place of peace. Through Him, we have also obtained access by faith, there it is, into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. What? That's this test. Don't miss it. Knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope. Now, fear and hope cannot coexist. So when you feel hope, when you have hope, fear's on his way out the door. And next week we're going to teach you how to be a hope dealer, because we're going to get this down in our hearts. And then we're going to realize God put us on planet for such a time as this to sling that hope everywhere. Here we go. Hope does not put us to shame. No more shame, no more fear, no more desire to control, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given as a person. And we're going to talk about Him next. So first, we stop ruling the world. Second, we start taking the test. Stop skipping class. It's time to take it. Here we go. And third, what brings all this together? We seek God's presence. We seek the face of God. We engage with the Father. We fellowship with the Son. We press into the presence of God Himself, the Holy Spirit. It's only in God's presence that you can get reconditioned. Beyond what your family taught you, beyond your cultural superstitions. You get reconditioned and you no longer can conceal anything. You're fully exposed and you're fully accepted by Him. And it's only in the presence of God, when you truly get there, that you give up control. You realize you don't need to be in control. The safest place for you to be is under His control. He's the one that is in control of absolutely everything. This is your times of worship. Man, my Spotify playlist is almost been on continually. Dive into worship, dive into the Word to spend time with Jesus, sit in His presence. You got a little more time nowadays. Wait on Him, make space for that. Let me end it this way. I'm gonna read my favorite psalm here in a second. The Psalms are the perfect place for you to go with your fears. And let me just give you that phrase. Don't ever be afraid to pray your fears or your tears. Don't ever be afraid. And I think as humans, we don't do this emotion thing very well. Even as Christians, we don't do this emotion thing very well. But I'm going to read you something here that's going to give you permission to turn your fears into prayers. Turn your tears into prayers. Psalm 42, this is one of my favorite psalms now. It's one of those psalms that you don't want it to be your favorite until you need it, and then it becomes your favorite. And then we've gone through a season or two where this has been our favorite, and this is perfect for times like this. We'll end with this. Psalm 42, verses 1 through 11. I'll read the whole psalm to you. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants, it's a word we don't use much, but just longs, desperately needs, so pants my soul for you, O God. Believe it or not, the image of is a dismayed deer. This is a anxious deer who came around the corner to the stream that he normally comes to each and every day, and now it's gone. It's just like the first time you went down aisle number 7 at Walmart and all the toilet paper was gone. No, sorry, just making light of it. But this is what this deer is feeling right now, like, wait a second. God, you're normally a little closer than you feel right now, and now I'm starting to get a little anxious. So This is the call for us to seek Him when, this is how we fear not, we seek His presence. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. I just don't need information about God right now. I need an encounter with God. I need an experience with a real, live, active God. When shall I come and appear before God? This psalmist here is a worship leader. And back in the Old Testament, you engaged with the presence of God in the temple. I mean, primarily that's what the temple was for. And really only the priest could get to the Holy of Holies. And here's the reality of what Jesus has done for you and I. By dying on the cross, one of the most vivid images in my mind is when Jesus died on the cross and He said, "It is finished." In the temple, the veil was torn in two. It was shredded in two, as if to say there is no longer separation between God's people and God's presence. And now the new temple is quite frankly, the new temple is you and I. We are the temple where God's presence can fully dwell. So we can actually take a step ahead on what the psalm, we can apply the psalmist's heart to our own self-isolation right now. We can let this passage be true for us right where we sit right now as you listen to this. My tears, verse 3, my tears have been my food day and night. I can tell God that? Oh, absolutely, you can tell God that. You can pray your fears, you can pray your tears. While they say to me all day long, this particular psalmist, where is your God? Being taunted. He's being taunted for standing up for his faith, for longing for an invisible God to meet him in this place of his anxiety. Verse 4, these things I remember. That's important. Go back to when God's steadfast love in your past and remind yourself that He is still faithful. As I pour out my soul, how I would go with the throng and lead them in procession to the house of God. He's remembering back to when he was that worship leader with glad shouts and songs of praise, a multitude keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul? The psalmist is actually talking to himself at this point. That's okay. He's using prayer to encourage himself. He's reminding his soul who's in control. That's a beautiful prayer. That's a huge step of faith. And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God. Telling himself, confessing being honest before God that right now I'm not feeling it. I'm telling myself to do it. I know you're going to sustain me in this moment. Bring me to a place of hope in God. And then he looks ahead. For I shall again, look at this faith, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. My soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon and Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep. At the, in the Hebrew, that actually reads a chaos calls to chaos. The chaos I'm feeling right now actually calls out to you, God. I'm having a hard time figuring you out. It's actually incredible poetry. Help me understand. You're praying this prayer, praying this fear, praying through the tears. At the roar of your waterfalls, all your breakers and your waves have gone over me. I mean, God, have you really allowed this? Are you still in control while this is happening to me, one of your beloved children? Yes, you can pray that way. By day, the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night, his song is with me. Are you kidding me? I can't see, but I'm going to sing. I'm going to hope in the dark and a prayer to the God of my life. Look at that faith. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? The vulnerability of that statement right there is unbelievable. Look at that. I say to God, the surest foundation I've ever stood upon. I know you're here. I know you can hear me. I know you're faithful. I know you're going to get through this, but let me ask you something right now. Where are you, right? Where are you? Why have you forgotten me? Oh, you can pray your fears. You can seek God and pray your tears at any given moment. Why do I go mourning? Because of the oppression of my enemy. God, these outside circumstances. Why are they affecting me this way? As with a deadly wound in my bones. God, this hurts. I don't like it, and I feel like I can't stop it. Please meet me here. My adversaries taunt me while they say to me all day long, where is your God? That's doubt creeping in, doubt creeping in, doubt. God, help me here. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? This is the bridge coming back. Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation and my God. When it comes to fear, when it comes to the emotion of fear, typically we're taught one of two ways to deal with it. Maybe you grew up where you're just told, look, deny it and suppress it. And it, really all feelings, you're taught to just deny it or suppress it. Or maybe you were taught, no, always express it and then follow it. Like just go with it and just vent it and be grumpy to everybody and just let it. And Christianity actually offers a third way. Jesus offers a third way. We're actually allowed to feel it and yet still trust. We're the ones who get to weep and worship all in the same moment, trusting God with those fears and trusting him with those tears. Only in Christianity can do it. And you're saying, Pastor Chris, how can you be so sure of this? Not only is it all over Psalms, not only do we see our heroes of the faith doing it, our own Savior, moments before carrying the heaviest burden the world has ever known, carrying the cross in the Garden of Gethsemane, cried out to his Father. And if you look closely, he's actually wondering if there's an alternative way to get through this. God, is this really the only way forward? He asks his Father. And truly, without even putting a period, comma, he goes on to say, but I trust you, not your will, but mine be done. He's sweating blood, according to the Gospel of Luke. He's crying out to his Father. There's no other Savior like that. He's truly a Savior who has suffered, who has felt the weight and wrestled with the weeping while still worshiping. Only Jesus, he's our God. There is no safer place for you to express your fear than in the presence of God. We're gonna stop. we're going to stop ruling the world. We're going to give that back to God. That's His job. He's in control. I don't care what the news says tomorrow. He's in control. I don't care what your heart says. Get off the throne of your own heart. He's in control. We're going to lean in to this test. Start taking these little ways that He's revealing what's really going on. Give Him full permission. But don't do it anywhere else but in His presence. Seek His presence. It's in the presence of God that you hear the greatest two words that you and I need right now. And they're simply these words: fear not. Let me pray with you right now. God, Your word is so clear that You are love. And it's only perfect love that casts out fear. So as we draw near to You, God, would You allow fear to be uprooted? Would You help us get off the throne and trying to stay in control and trying to conceal, God? Would You help us lean into to whatever You're trying to teach us, even through this anxiety, God? God, we need Your freedom. Would You take us from fear to freedom, Lord, through faith? Help us to trust You in this time. God, I pray over any anxiety, any lingering worry. God, would this simple teaching just be a blessing, not only to those who are hearing it now, but to those who are going to hear it in the future, Lord. Use this to bless so many people. God, thank You for Manna Church, the way they're looking to You, the way they're taking care of each other. God, we trust You, and we want to learn how to fear not by seeking Your presence. Do what only You can do in our midst, God. We need You and we trust You. Amen. Keep your head bowed. One more moment, one last prayer. If you are not connected to God Himself, then none of this is possible. You will remain anxious. You will stay in worry. If you'd like to start a relationship with Jesus right now, I'm going to just lead you in this prayer. Pray this prayer with me in your heart. Not just knowledge about Jesus, but truly a relationship with Him that begins like this. God, I confess my sin to You. I need You and I trust You. Come into my life and change my life as only You can. Thank You, Jesus, for rescuing me. And it's in Your name I trust. Amen. Amen. Manna Church, we'll be back here next week. So blessed to be your pastor. God bless you guys. Let's fear not this week so we can be the people of hope that God designed us to be. Love you guys. God bless you.